Good evening from Washington, D.C. I'm Charles Croucher and I'm coming on air from the heart of a nation once again grappling with its own future after yet another election for the history books. Donald Trump, the former president, is now once again president-elect, denying Kamala Harris momentum in what's being called the most astonishing political comeback in all time here in America. At this hour, all of our affiliates, CNN, still have Donald Trump just shy of the 270 electoral college votes he would need to secure victory, but he will get there. Even in the popular vote, which the president-elect has never won, he leads Kamala Harris by more than 5 million votes. Speaking to the party faithful in Florida, the president-elect says he has survived assassination attempts for this moment. His dedicated MAGA supporters celebrating the win and continuing that party into the morning near his Mar-a-Lago home. N9's Jonathan Kersley has been with them every step of the way.
Donald Trump arriving to applause. The 78-year-old addressing the faithful, declaring victory after all the numbers stacked up in his favour.
I want to thank the American people for the extraordinary honour of being elected your 47th president and your 45th president.
He sensed success hours before, greeted by a room full of his closest supporters at his Mar-a-Lago home. In the crowd, chief cheerleader and billionaire Elon Musk, who on X called it early, game, set, match. Australia's richest woman, Gina Rinehart, also in the crowd. On the streets outside,
Florida is roaring right now.
Yes.
Donald Trump supporters tuning in, and they liked what they were seeing.
Everything's looking good from what I see it on TV.
The first building blocks of the Republican candidate's red wall were falling into place.
CNN projects that Donald Trump will win the state of Florida with its 30 electoral votes, as expected. Donald Trump, CNN projects, will win the state of Tennessee, as expected, with its 11 electoral votes.
Fox News can project that former President Trump will win the state of Indiana.
Trump will also carry nearby Kentucky for a
It was early
time,
days, but there was little blue on the map of red.
Donald Trump has 154 electoral votes. Kamala Harris has 27 electoral votes. 270 are needed to win.
Judgment Day. Trump's campaign continued until the very end.
Our Republicans, we're doing really well. If you're in line, stay in line. Don't let them take you off that line. Vote.
After two assassination attempts, the former president felt bulletproof as he cast his vote.
No, I feel very confident. I have felt, you know, we went in with a very big lead today.
Wife Melania by his side, he pushed back when asked to control his supporters.
I don't have to tell them that. And I certainly don't want any violence, but I certainly don't have to tell. These are great people. These are people that believe in no violence. Unlike your question, you believe in violence.
President Trump does not win this election. There will be rioting. People are going to go crazy.
And in his corner, he had a Kennedy plotting his reign.
He wants a revolution, and I think he's going to get one.
But a victory first. Trump seizing momentum and clinching one of the must-win battleground states.
CNN projects that Donald Trump will win the state of North Carolina. This is the first of 7 battleground states that we're keeping an eye on.
Georgia was next to fall, and it wasn't the last. A shock even to his most stalwart defenders.
What we have, Pennsylvania, is this a call, ladies and gentlemen?
It was.
The Fox News decision desk can now officially project that Donald Trump will become the 47th president of the United States.
This will truly be the golden age of America. That's what we have to know.
Once again, Donald Trump has defied his doubters and his critic. Tonight, he makes his way home to Mar-a-Lago to go to sleep as the president-elect of the United States once more. And the world waits to see what comes next. the oldest person to run for the presidency, the first with a criminal conviction, and the first in 132 years to win a second non-consecutive term, a comeback that's made political history. At Mar-a-Lago in Florida, Jonathan Kersley, Nine News.
The president-elect might be sleeping right about now, but US correspondent Jonathan Kersley is not. He remains in Mar-a-Lago, Florida for us. Jono, it's just after 5 a.m. where you are, but there are the diehard supporters. Have they cleared out or are they finding somewhere to party on?
A couple of them have returned and you would expect more to come back over the course of today. They cleared off not too long after Donald Trump made that speech at the Palm Beach County Convention Center, about 6 kilometres or so from where I'm standing. And then we saw Donald Trump make his way back here. But for his supporters, it had been scenes of jubilation. They were popping champagne corks and celebrating in this car park before he had even got to his feet. Many of them say that this is a moment they have been waiting for 4 years. Essentially, they view him as a messiah, and tonight it seems as though he is returning to the White House. As I mentioned, Donald Trump made his way inside Mar-a-Lago a few hours ago. It remains to be seen exactly what his new day is going to bring. But soon, Charles, the sun will rise here in West Palm Beach, Florida, on a new dawn for Donald Trump and a new dawn for America too.
Those crowds will likely flock back to where you are. Jono, go and get some sleep. Thank you. Let's bring in our US correspondent, my colleague and my friend, Lauren Tomasi. She's in the battleground state of Pennsylvania tonight. She's been there with supporters of both sides. Lauren, good evening. That battle was won by Donald Trump. What did the voters tell you did it for them?
Look, Charles, good evening to you. It was such an interesting state to watch here. You and I have both talked about how important Pennsylvania was to this race, and in the end, it was the slam dunk for Donald Trump. Voters right here in Philadelphia, this was a county that was won by Kamala Harris, but in the end, it was the state of Pennsylvania that sealed the fate for Donald Trump. We've crisscrossed this state and spoken to so many voters in the likes of Northampton County, which is such an important bellwether. In the end, it has come within a percentage in those kind of counties. It is so close, but then in other areas it has taken off towards Donald Trump. I've been in both camps across the city tonight. There were elated Donald Trump supporters and very defeated Kamala Harris supporters across the city. This was a place where both of these candidates ended their campaigns, their final stops in this long-running and historic campaign. But look, certainly tonight it has gone in Donald Trump's favour. And the show now rolls on. We've got cars back on the roads this morning and people are waking up to go to their jobs. Life is turning a brand new page, and with Independence Hall behind me here, Charles, it certainly is a historic mark to turn this new chapter.
It's seen a lot, that hall, Lauren, and this is just another chapter, as you say. Thank you. All right, let's go to Jared Monshine. He is the Director of Research at the United States Study Centre in Sydney. He joins us now. Jared, thank you for your time. Firstly, coming into today, did you expect anything like this?
Well, I definitely saw a Trump victory as a possibility, but I guess I was, to be honest, expecting there to not be much of an answer for maybe a day or two. The fact that Trump not only won but won so decisively was, to be honest, a bit surprising. I thought it would take a longer amount of time to know states like Pennsylvania, but the fact that he was able to perform so well in not only, you know, North Carolina and Georgia, but also in Pennsylvania, that really sealed the deal, and that allowed us to know who won the election fairly quickly by historical standards.
Coming into this election, the gender divide had been prominent. It'd been prominent in the campaign, and in the wake of the Supreme Court's decision to overturn Roe v. Wade, there was an expectation that women would come out and perhaps propel Kamala Harris to the White House as the first woman. Did we see that in the results?
We definitely saw a gendered election, arguably the most gendered election in modern American history. But it just wasn't enough female support for Harris. And I should note that that support actually goes beyond just white women. It includes a lot of non-white women. If you look at the way that Donald Trump actually got more votes as the Republican candidate than any other Republican presidential candidate in modern American history. That's not because of all non-white voters. It's particularly because of Hispanic men and Black men. Those two demographics in particular showed a significant swing towards Harris. Now, Trump did not win all of them or the majority of them, but he won such a sizable amount that it was just enough to tip it over towards Donald Trump.
Put yourself in the role of future historian. What are the lessons that we've learned from this campaign?
Oh, there's so many different lessons to learn. I mean, I guess we still need to see the exit polls and the demographics and how exactly this electoral loss occurred for Harris. But I think at the end of the day, the Democrats have to wonder if they just need a stronger candidate. There was a lot of questions about Kamala Harris. Ultimately, she was one of the very few Democratic politicians who were less popular than Joe Biden himself, whose popularity is in the high 30s, low 40s. And so maybe that was a risk. Maybe they needed to have more of a Democratic primary to sort of fine-tune and test out the other options for the Democrats moving forward. I think it's still too early to tell what the takeaways are, but more than anything, I think Democrats will want to have more of a stronger candidate moving forward in 2028.
Final question. We know that Australia and the US have been brought closer by AUKUS and the Quad. What's it mean for our relationship, this result?
You know, as an American in Australia, I've been asked about this election for some time, about all elections and about Donald Trump for many years. And, I said, if you look at Australian interest in U.S. politics, it's sort of unbelievable to me. In 2016, they consumed more information about the U.S. election than they did their own that year. And in 2020, Australians Googled U.S. election news more than they did COVID. But I also said at the same time, the stakes could not have been lower for Australia, because I think there's so many structural issues that make the U.S.-Australia alliance far broader than any one president or prime minister. There's a reason that both Albanese and his predecessor, Scott Morrison, both got state dinners by Donald Trump and Joe Biden. There's a reason that AUKUS is likely to go ahead regardless of this electoral outcome. There's a reason that the U.S.-Australia alliance has weathered decades of history and very different prime ministers and presidents. I think ultimately the structural dynamics, the U.S. national interests and the Australian national interests are so aligned that I think, yes, there will be lots of different twists and turns in the relationship, but on the whole, they are more aligned than ever and continuing to align regardless of this electoral outcome.
A busy and interesting 4 years ahead, Jared. We appreciate your time tonight. Large parts of the world are waking up to the news out of the United States. Let's head live to Nine's Europe correspondent, Edward Godfrey, who is in London for us this evening. Edward, good morning to you there. Take us through the reaction in London and in Europe.
Well, Charles, you're right. Yeah, large parts of the world are waking up and world leaders all over are reacting to another Trump presidency. Some no doubt enthused about that. Others perhaps a little more anxious, starting here in the UK with Prime Minister Sir Keir Starmer. He's saying he's congratulated Donald Trump, saying he looks forward to working together with him in the years ahead, saying, as the closest of allies, we stand shoulder to shoulder in defence of our shared values of freedom, democracy and enterprise. Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu was among the first to make a statement, saying, congratulations on history's greatest comeback. Your historic return to the White House offers a new beginning for America and a powerful recommitment to the great alliance between Israel and America. This is a huge victory. Now, with a growing war in the Middle East, a change of presidency will be significant. Israel and the US are very close allies. The US supplies much of Israel's arsenal. The Biden administration repeatedly doubled down in its support for Israel while publicly and privately trying to de-escalate the conflict with Israel and Hamas and Hezbollah and Iran, but seemingly wasn't able to have a lot of influence on Israel's decisions. So it'll be interesting to see what a Trump presidency would mean for that war. On to another major conflict. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky is another to post on X, saying Ukraine, as one of Europe's strongest military powers, is committed to ensuring long-term peace and security in Europe and the transatlantic community with the support of our allies. Now, the war with Russia has been going on for more than 2.5 years. Trump has previously said he would end the war should he return to the White House. The big question will be exactly how he would do that and what shape that would take. French President Emmanuel Macron has also posted saying, ready to work together as we did for 4 years, with your convictions and mine, with respect and ambition for more peace and prosperity. And NATO Secretary General Mark Rutte has tweeted saying, I look forward to working with him again to advance peace through strength through NATO. So, Charles, a change of leadership in the United States, but one, as we know, which has a huge ripple effect right around the world and a big impact on politics everywhere and lives everywhere too, Charles.
Yeah, when you change the president, you change the world. We just don't know how quite yet. Edward, thank you. There is news just in. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese has congratulated Donald Trump on the win tonight. Here are the Prime Minister's words.
I congratulate President Trump on his victory in the election, and I look forward to working in the interests of both of our nations. Australia and the United States are great friends. Based upon our common values, the relationship that we have in areas like national security, our trade, and importantly, our commitment to great democracies. And we've seen the American people have their say today, and they've elected Donald Trump as the President of the United States, and I congratulate him on his election.
And from opposition leader Peter Dutton, he just posted, may the years ahead be some of our most defining for the alliance, and may we unleash the defence, industrial and economic opportunities of AUKUS at speed and scale. That's Peter Dutton earlier this evening. Well, let's have a look now as we are joined by former Reagan staffer Kim Hoggard, who has been a part of our program throughout the evening. We appreciate her time and staying up again. Kim, what stood out to you most about the results that you're seeing so far?
Well, I agree with other people that have spoken earlier on your program that I'm not surprised that he's won, but I am surprised that it's looking to be a very significant win, and not only that, a win in the popular vote, which he never obtained before. And I've read, don't know this myself, but I've read that one of the reasons that he campaigned in some states that were considered not to be Republican, that they were Democrat states, such as California and New York, and even Virginia, he ran in order to try to run up his popular vote count. So I think it must have been personally important to him, because he might not have felt that his first time winning in 2020 with just the Electoral College was enough to legitimize his win. So that was a canny desire on his part to achieve that. So, and also that the result, it was so quick to come, and that just shows that the people that the Democrats were expecting to turn out for Harris didn't turn out for her, and that was a lot of Latino vote. She didn't get the Latino vote that Biden got. He got about 65% of that vote. She got about half, and working class voters really still connected with Biden, and I think for the Democrats, he was the last holdover or holdout on those votes. They really are Republican voters now.
Kamala Harris is the second woman to lose to Donald Trump. By my count, there's been 5 tickets that have a woman somewhere on there, either as president or vice president. Only one, and that is Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, has been successful. Is America just not ready for a female president, or just not ready for this female president?
Oh, I think both Hillary Clinton and Kamala Harris were two qualified women who were capable of holding the presidency. I think America, I do think that's a factor in Harris's loss. I think it's a sad commentary on where America is. I know a lot of the people that I've spoken to in America who were Republicans, people that I worked with in the Reagan and Bush administrations, they were not enthusiastic about her. And they said quite, you know, stridently that they were not determining their vote based on her gender. They just felt that she wasn't qualified. I respectfully disagree. But I find it ironic that American voters in 2020 were complaining about two old men running for office in Biden and Trump, and were calling for generational change, which she represented, and still decided to go back to a 78-year-old former president to be their leader once again. So I do find there a bit of hypocrisy in that decision. I know a lot of Americans will say, well, it was the economy. And I do think the Biden administration did not do a good job at touting their own economic record. I suppose there'll be a lot of reflections on how Harris could have made a better case for her campaign. But as a previous person you spoke to said, she only had just over 100 days to get it done. She stuck to the script. Trump didn't. And that people seem to prefer the strong man leader at this point in America's history.
Welcome back to our election coverage after an extraordinary night in American history. And as you can see behind me, the sun is rising over the Capitol, leading to a second extraordinary day. Donald Trump claiming victory to become the nation's 47th president when he's sworn in at the building behind me in January. Joining me now is John Hart, a US political expert from the Australian National University in Canberra. John, good evening to you. Thanks for your time. Firstly, what did you make of the results as they stand right now?
Well, one thing that is clear is the results showed that most of the polls were wrong. They portrayed, or at least the averaging of polls, gave the impression that the race was very, very close. And I think most commentary tended to be based on that during the campaign. In the end, it turned out not to be close. Kamala Harris was 5 million votes short of Donald Trump's popular vote in the nation at large, as well as losing in the Electoral College. That's the first thing. Secondly, I think it's not definitive yet, but it looks like the economic issues and the cost of living issues outranked the abortion issue, the democracy issue, yeah. Trump's threat to democracy, Trump's character. All those things resonated less with the electorate than the cost of living. And Kamala Harris was in a bit of an unenviable position of having to defend Joe Biden's economic record. And I think it illustrates a point about incumbent vice presidents who run for president. Most of them don't succeed. That is, run for president while they are actually vice president. In the last 100 years, you've had Richard Nixon in 1960, Hubert Humphrey in 1968, Al Gore in 2000, and now Kamala Harris in 2024. The only incumbent vice president who's ever won the presidency from the vice presidency was George Bush in 1988. So I think it illustrates that vice presidents are in a particularly difficult position. She was constrained in terms of how she could campaign. She certainly couldn't criticize Joe Biden. I agree with your previous speaker. She didn't have a great deal of time to establish a campaign appeal that resonated with voters.
Given that, should Joe Biden have stepped down earlier?
Yes, I think he should. I think it was initially when he became president, he talked about being a one-term president and handing over to a new generation. And Kamala Harris certainly made that new generation line a key plank of her campaign. That didn't work. And I think looking back on it, Biden has got to carry some of the blame for hanging on too long.
Finally, what happens next for the Democrats?
A lot of soul-searching. They need to look very carefully at where they lost votes in 2024 that they had in 2020. That will require not just impressionistic gut feelings about what went wrong. It will require a lot of hard data, a lot of survey data. And I think at the bottom of it, what the Democratic Party are likely to find is that the traditional Democratic base is declining even faster than we estimated. The working class Democrat voter now seems to be firmly in the Republican camp. If the Democrats can reverse that, well, I'm not sure how they can do it at the moment. But their current appeal clearly isn't working. And not working in an extraordinary year where there has been no candidate like Donald Trump. No candidate has run the kind of controversial campaign that he's run. It's makes it even harder to explain the Democratic defeat. But I think a careful, reflective study of survey data about what voters were doing will be important. And remember, this is carried through to congressional level races as well. The Democrats have done pretty badly in the Senate. They've lost control of the Senate, and it's certainly not clear that they're going to win control of the House. Probably not. So Trump will come into office with a Republican Senate, probably a Republican House, and of course a Republican Supreme Court. So we do have to worry about how the traditional constitutional checks and balances in the American system are going to work.
As he did in 2016. Hey, John, thanks so much for being part of the program tonight. You're watching Nine's election special on what is a new day, you can see by the sun, here in Washington, D.C. It's been an extraordinary few hours with Donald Trump making one of the greatest political comebacks the world has ever seen. We're joined now to discuss this and more by our next guest, April Parmalee. She was the Assistant Secretary of State under George W. Bush and now heads up the Australian Chamber of Commerce, Australian-American Chamber of Commerce in Australia. April, thank you so much for joining us. Tell us, what does business look like under Donald Trump, the man who ran to be good for business?
Good morning. This is a good thing in many ways for a lot of the sectors of the economy. You've seen the dollar, the U.S. dollar surge on the election of Donald Trump. The shares for Truth Social and Tesla are off the charts. And of course, Bitcoin reached a record high today. We'll see the traditional energy stocks flying higher as well on the hopes of the drill baby drill president coming into office. And most businesses are expecting that he will have a less regulatory approach, which would mean that there'd be more movement in the M&A market.
Yeah, less regulatory, except for when it comes to tariffs on some of the imports. What's the feeling amongst Australian businesses about imports and exports, given that looming threat?
I think it's a wait-and-see situation with the tariffs. Under Trump 1.0, there was a lot of talk, and what I counseled our members to do was to look at what President Trump did and not just listen to what he said, because his actions often were very pro-business, while his rhetoric was a little bit more undisciplined. And so looking at what he has said he's going to do on corporate taxes is very promising for a lot of businesses. If he does continue the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act that he put into place in 2017, and which will expire next year, and bring the corporate tax rate down even further to 15%, that is going to mean that the Australian corporate tax rate of 30% really is an outlier and stands out pretty starkly against what's available in the United States. The costs of energy will also be pretty dramatically different between the United States and Australia. But I don't think anybody's panicking just yet about these tariffs that he's talked about. You'll remember that he imposed Section 232 on steel tariffs during his last presidency. And through some very deft maneuvering, we were able to escape those tariffs because he sees Australia as a strong and important ally. And we have a good balance of trade with them. And since he was president last time, we've also promised to invest $3 billion in the AUKUS nuclear submarine deal into America. So things are going in the right direction.
In your experience with him and with his administrations in the past, do you think he has a place in his heart for Australia, or at least a respect for Australia, given we have that trade deficit?
Yeah, I do. I feel very strongly that not only President Trump, but most of the MAGA Republicans who I've met in Washington, and I have spent a lot of time meeting them when I've been in the States the last five or six times, as well as senators, congressmen, and the bureaucrats, have a very big place in their heart for Australia. Whenever I go over to America as chairman of AmCham's of the Asia Pacific, people very much want to talk about Australia before any of the other countries in the region. They see it as the anchor of democracy in the Pacific, and they've been very interested to hear what it was like in Australia during the period where we were suffering from the economic coercion from the CCP after the inquiry into the origins of COVID. So Australia, I think, will continue to have a high place on the American subconscious, but especially Donald Trump should be well disposed to liking Australia again.
Well, the opening bell is a few hours away on Wall Street, and we'll see what our markets do tomorrow as well. April, thanks for your time this evening.
Thank you.